Hi, Dave Parrish here, and today I'm going to talk about how to make astoundingly good bread. Now, I know good is a relative term, and there are a lot of opinions floating around out there, and good may be just considered a matter of personal preference. However, I've discovered a bread that has enough of the characteristics that most people like, that is almost universally adored by anyone who tastes it. And I never tire of watching people as they take their first bite of this bread, and the look on their face goes from one of just moderate expectation to surprise, and then very quickly changes over to sheer delight as they realize that what they just ate was not just any ordinary bread, it was also an experience. So what sets this bread apart from something you might even find in a high-end bakery? Well, I just don't see how this particular methodology lends itself well to a commercial application. Since bakeries also need to make money, compromises are usually made. Rapid rise yeast and bread soured with vinegar is commonplace. Real sourdough is often cooked en masse in a steam-injected oven, but this doesn't really effectively trap the hot gases close to the surface of the crust when it's cooking. Also, sometimes the sheer volume of bread being processed leads to rough handling of the dough immediately prior to cooking. This creates a dense loaf with unimpressive loft and texture, though the flavor does tend to be quite good. The crust should be chewy, crispy, crackly, but not so hard or so thick that you need a bread saw to cut into it. And there's a store just a few blocks away from my home that literally has a bread saw to cut artisan bread. And it sounds like they're cutting plywood, and when you eat it, you come away with the sensation that somebody just took a wire brush to the inside of your mouth. The characteristics of the crust are largely determined by how it's cooked and whether or not you're successful in trapping hot gases as they escape from the bread and holding them close to the surface of the crust for a duration of time during the cooking process. And this is something that just by sheer volume of bread that bakeries are working with, that oftentimes is not very practical. The texture should be chewy, springy, with air pockets uniformly distributed throughout. This particular bread yields a texture fine enough to make a sandwich, and texture is largely determined by the sourdough organism, the length of time it's allowed to develop, and the success of the final rise at the time of cooking. A high rise lends a light and airy low density while maintaining the desirable qualities of texture. This is largely determined by the surface tension of the final loaf before cooking, the length of time for the second rise, and the degree of care taken to place the dough gently into the covered baker. Character. This might well be described as depth and complexity of flavor. This is a result of not only the ingredients that you use, which should be high quality ingredients, but also the time that the dough is allowed to develop and transform simple ingredients into more complex components. Now, the sourdough start is an important aspect of this. And this particular sourdough start, I'm told, is 187 years old. Now, when I received it, I was told it was 183 years old. I don't know how you would go about quantifying this, but what does seem to be the case is that the more you use it and the older it gets, the more complex flavor profile that you develop, and that lends a great flavor and character to the bread, which you will never get if you try to substitute rapid-rised yeast and sour the bread with vinegar, which is actually a fairly common practice in large-scale operations, just for matters of volume and convenience of moving bread through. And one more thing, I know that this is not very scientific, but I find that it has it actually plays a part in my bread. You can call it overly sentimental, you can call it anecdotal, but I find that when I'm making bread for other people, it actually performs better. So I'm always planning on giving away bread. I always hold back at least one loaf for myself so I can taste what I just gave away. I call it quality control if you wish, but the love with which it's made seems to have a big impact on the quality of the bread that you make. Oh yeah, one more thing. no hair. Shave it off, tie it up, cover it up, but whatever you do, keep it out of the bread. The best bread in the world is greatly diminished and falls quickly from grace with the addition of one single human hair. Now, some people might consider bread more like magic, and they consider that all the secrets of good bread should be cloaked in subtlety and mystery. There are other people that might consider it an art form, an expression of themselves, and other people who consider that an art form may feel woefully under-equipped or qualified to make good bread, while others might still consider it's something best left to the masters who have been schooled under prestigious tutelage through culinary school. I am not a wizard, I'm not an artist, I have never been schooled in the culinary disciplines. What I am is a chemist, and as such, I consider, you know, amazing bread within the grasp of anyone. And why would I say that? Because it is all about the chemistry. You have certain equipment that you use, you have ingredients that you combine in certain ways, in certain proportions, you manage time, you manage temperature, and if anyone manages all of the variables in the same way, I say chemistry is no respecter of persons. That means it performs the same way for anyone. Bread is the same way. If you just manage the variables, if you will take some time and attention and rely on some of your powers of observation, combine all of the things in the right proportions in the right way, and manage your time and timing and your temperature, anyone can produce astounding bread. So let's come into my kitchen and let's make some bread that'll knock your socks off. For starters, we take 1 cup of water. This is filtered water. My sink filter. And we're going to take 1 cup of start. I have 3 different starts here. I want to explain why I have them. This one is one that was reconstituted from some that we dried on parchment paper. We just wanted to see if this would work. And you can see that it's got the bubbles in here. It's got kind of a thick, viscous nature. And if you take the spoon and stick it in here, you'll see that it kind of sloughs off like that. You see, it's kind of snotty. That's exactly what we want. So before I use it, I want to use this one just to see how well it works. I think it's going to be fine. I want to mix it up. It kind of gets a liquid on the surface. They call that hooch. You don't want to throw that away. That's part of the whole process. And over time, if you don't feed it and don't stir it for a while, you get a significant amount of separation, and the liquid goes to the surface and it turns quite brown. Even more so than this, if you want to zoom in on this or look at this, you see that. We want to stir that in and make it all homogeneous. So this, and then this little one is my backup. In case I do something catastrophic to my other, I always have a backup. And I use a lot of this, and so I have a big pot here, a vat or honey pot, that I keep about this full of start, because I will use about 4 cups when I make bread. I use 1 cup for each loaf. So I'm going to stir this in well, make sure that it's all mixed in, and then pour 1 cup of start. You see how that looks? That's how it should look. Now, if it's a little thinner than this, it's okay, because it goes too far, or if it goes farther, then this is progressed. That's okay, but it just may affect the amount of flour you need to add to the final product. So I'm going to take this, pour it into the water, get as much out as I can. A little bit of this makes a difference. So you wanna scrape out as much as you can. Clean out your measuring cup. Pretty
pretty well. And then you have this here, you just mix it in and make sure that it's all evenly distributed throughout. Now this is something, the next step is something that I have always done. I haven't tried it without it. I've seen other people do it without it, but I just feel more comfortable stirring the salt in at this point and making sure that it's all dissolved and evenly distributed out. Let me talk about the salt. I use sea salt, and some people will tell you sea salt is just an expensive table salt. And sodium chloride, which is the major component, is sodium chloride, and there's no difference between Morton salt and sea salt. That's just not true. There's a lot deeper, more complex mineral profile in sea salt than there is in table salt, and it does make a difference in the flavor profile of the bread. Trust me on this. You can try it without. It's not going to be as good. One of these other options is the Redmond Real Salt, all-natural sea salt. This looks like it has flecks of dirt in it, or you know, some coloration. And truth is, it is a little bit dirt. And I stopped using this. This is kind of a pricey, spendy salt. I stopped using this because I didn't like the grit that it imparted. Just a little bit of it. You occasionally in a bite of bread, you'll get some grit. I didn't like that, so I went with this sea salt. It seems to get excellent results, good flavor, without the grit. So this is what I prefer. So to this mixture of water and start, I'm going to add 1 3/4 teaspoon of salt. So this is 1 teaspoon. Teaspoon and 1/4 teaspoon. I suppose I could have gone with 1/2 tablespoon and 1/4 teaspoon as well. So there we go. That is 1 3/4 teaspoon of sea salt. What I'm going to do is I'm just going to stir this until it's pretty well dissolved and mixed throughout. And it just takes a minute before to accomplish that. And I'm feeling that just, you can feel at the end of the spatula that it's dissolving. You no longer feel that grit and grind as the salt dissolves. So to this mixture of water, sourdough start, and salt, I'm going to add 3 3/4 cup of flour. Now, I used to use 3.5, and I found that it just behaved a lot better given the circumstances and the progression of the start to do 3 3/4. But what's most important is how the dough looks once you get it all mixed in, and I'll show you that. So this is 3 3/4 cup of all-purpose flour. I'll talk to you about the brand that I like. I'm sure that there are a lot of brands that will work well. There are some that probably won't work as well, and that's going to be an important factor in the outcome of your bread. So if you're in an area where you don't have Lehigh Roller Mills Turkey brand all-purpose flour, you're going to be looking for an ideal flour that will give you the results you want. At some other time I will give you the specifications, I think, of the protein content and all that of the turkey flour. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to mix this in by hand, and at least start it by hand. I used to do the whole thing by hand, and I started to make more loaves of bread. I make a lot of loaves and I give a lot away, and it was just making my arms tired. I started using a KitchenAid mixer to just get all the flour and the water mixed in. This looks like a kind of a raggy dough right now, but I want to scrape all the sides off. I want to make sure there are no dry pockets, And that means like a pocket of flour that is not moistened by the water in here. So once I've done this and mixed it all in, I'm going to scrape this off and get as much in back in here as I can. And then I'm going to put it with a dough hook. Now I'm not really kneading it, I'm just mixing it. And the gluten will form on its own over time if it has enough moisture content. You let it sit and vent. It has to breathe. That's something I'll talk about. So here we have our start, our flour, our water, and our salt. And that's all it is. So I'm going to put it over here in the KitchenAid. Also, I find if I mix the flour in first, it doesn't throw flour all over when I put it in the KitchenAid. And I'm just going to turn it on, kind of medium. Starts to hold together and make one ball. Now occasionally I'll see some bits and pieces of unmixed flour and water on the bottom. And just to help speed it along, I'll take the spatula and I'll push everything down and reform this ball on there. Right now it seems like it's a pretty stiff dough, and you'll find with time that it becomes very, very moist and sticky. And if you don't have something that holds together at this point and it's stringing to the side and not forming a ball, you will have an unmanageable bundle of dough later on that will not hold a good loaf, and it will have a slump to it and it won't have enough surface tension. So I'm going to mix this a little bit more, one more time. And you'll notice that it's pulled away from the side here, and it's formed one loaf, or one lump of dough. You have no stickiness or strings to the side. You want just enough flour that's what you get. So this whole thing holds together in one piece and has no strings going to the side. Now if I were to keep mixing this, it would get a little bit more sticky as the flour gets mixed in. So now I take it and I put it in one of these Rubbermaid 3.7 liter cake-alongs. These are really cheap Tupperware and with a snapping airtight lid. And one of the things you cannot see is that right in the very center I have poked a very small hole with a tack, and that is to allow it to breathe and not pop the lid off, because I don't want that. So I'm going to take the bread now, the dough, and throw it in here. You see how cleanly that came out? That's how it should come out. And I'm going to flatten it down in here along the bottom and set it aside to rise for somewhere around 10 hours. Now, depending on how the start has progressed, it might take 8 and it might take closer to 12 hours, but generally it's about 10 hours. What I want to do is let it sit at room temperature, which in our house I think it is about 72 degrees. Let it sit at room temperature until it has risen to just barely touch the inside of the lid, and that's when I'll take it to the next step in the second rise. So, this is a done deal. I mentioned earlier that I use Turkey brand all-purpose flour from Lehigh Roller Mills. That wasn't quite accurate. It's actually unbleached bread flour. And this, for me, is the ideal flour to use for the sourdough. Now, I don't know how widely distributed this flour brand is, but if you're not able to find it, you're going to have to find something that works as well, trial and error.
Okay, so here it is. It's been rising for about 9.5 hours, and it is touching the top, the inside. That's exactly where we want it. It has a nice light feel to it. So what we're going to do is take a oiled spatula. We use spray oil, the canola spray oil. You spray the spatula and you use that to scrape the dough out of the Tupperware into or onto a generously floured surface. So I'm going to spread a little bit of our turkey flour here. Now, notice that over time you've developed the gluten without any kneading at all. If you pull this away, you can see these strands, almost like spider web. And that's what holds the gas and helps it to rise. And so it's a beautiful dough. It feels great. And we will scrape this out. And it's also very, very wet and sticky now. So if we had started out with wet and sticky, this would be unmanageable. That's why we wanted the certain consistency after we mixed the flour the first 9 hours ago. Okay, so what I have over here is oiled parchment paper. This is about, 16 inches square or so. And I very lightly sprayed it with cooking oil, and then put two pieces face to face that were both sprayed and just kind of rubbed them around to make it evenly distributed. You don't want to have it so that it's dripping off. You can see that. It just looks shiny. And on this paper, I'm going to spread some semolina flour. This is like magic dust. It's great. It's like little ball bearings, and it helps your bread to not stick to the bread and to the parchment when you're trying to move it into the cooking dish. So just spread a little bit of the semolina flour, shake it. So this is the side where I'm going to lay the loaf right here. I take it outside of the pan about 2.5 inches. Okay, and then I'm going to spread just a little bit more flour right here. On this, I'm going to spread just a little bit of sesame seed. That just gives the bread some nice texture and flavor. Just a little bit like that. So, this, what we do with the loaf at this point is actually going to determine the final look of the bread. So what I do is very gently spread it out into a square. I don't want to beat the tar out of it. I just want to be gentle and spread it out. And then I'm going to fold it in half one time, right like that. Okay, and then I'm going to spread it out a little bit again, a little bit more. Out this side, and I'm going to fold it a second time. So what you're going to have is actually two seams like that. Okay? You'll see why that's important later on. And I'm going to roll it seam side down and onto the floured surface and just kind of make my loaf here. Just shape my loaf. Just kind of round the edges and make it look pretty good. Shake off the excess flour like that and lay it gently on your sesame seeds. Okay. And then you're going to fold this over and roll this like that. And do it loosely. You want to give some room for the bread to expand. I'm going to do that for the second loaf. Now you'll notice here that I have four loaves or four Tupperwares that I'm working with. I'm going to do two loaves, and since I only have two cooking dishes and it's going to be about 25 minutes full cook time, I'm going to delay the formation of these loaves for 25 minutes. Okay, so you don't need to watch that, but I'm going to make another loaf, and I'm going to let this rise loosely covered with a little bit of saran wrap for about an hour and 25 minutes, an hour and a half max. Okay, so here I have the two loaves on the cookie sheet, wrapped in parchment paper that's been oiled, covered with semolina flour, sprinkled with sesame seed, and lightly covered with saran wrap. Now, I'm going to set the timer for 1 hour, and that's because in 1 hour I'm going to turn on the oven, as the oven takes about 20 minutes to heat up to 465 degrees. Now, in my oven, when I turn it on and it comes up to temperature, it uses the upper element and the lower element just to get up to temperature, and then it uses the bottom element to maintain the temperature. So what I want to do, since I know that while the bread is cooking, the bottom element is the only one that's going to be really active, I want to move the bread as far away from the bottom element to prevent it from burning on the bottom of the bread, and still be able to get the baking dishes into the oven without burning my knuckles. So you notice that we have two racks and we have five positions that we can position the racks. It so happens that the third level is the ideal level for my oven in order to accomplish all that I want to accomplish. I want to move it away as far as possible and then still have some headspace so I can get the baking dishes in and out without burning my knuckles. So that's level three for me. Now I want to say something about the dough. How do you know if you've let it rise too far? Well, what will happen is it will start to collapse on itself, and you'll notice a change in the texture. Right now, if I make my loaf, I have good surface tension. I can feel it. It wants to spring back when I stretch it out, and that's important in order to get a high rise on the bread. You need to have some resistance and some surface tension. If it goes too far, you will actually get a more sour flavor, but you will get a loaf that doesn't rise as high, and I say it has kind of a slump to it. As you're working it on the floured surface, you'll notice that it doesn't spring back, it yields very easily to any manipulation and doesn't want to spring back, and that's how you know if you've let it go too far. So generally 10 hours is the maximum I usually let it rise. If it isn't touching the inside surface or very close to touching the inside surface, I might let it go for a little bit longer, but you'll know when you start to see it collapse that you've let it go too far. And you can still make a loaf with it. It just won't perform to its full potential if you do that. Okay, so here we have the first two loaves. They have another 14 minutes to go before I turn on the oven. And then the other two loaves are 25 minutes behind, and they're both rising nicely. Now over here is kind of the secret weapon to truly amazing bread, and that is in a clay covered baker. The whole concept behind sourdough is it requires a lot of heat very quickly, and so it's being baked in a very hot oven at 465 to 475 depending on your oven, and it's baked in a preheated baking dish, and so you're dealing with very hot tools in order to bake your bread. What you want to do is bake the bread handling it very gently, so you lay it into the dish, the baking dish or the baking surface, without degassing it. Now a lot of the demonstrations that I've seen, They're very rough with the bread at this point because they're dealing with very hot items and they have high sides. And so how do you get a loaf into something with high sides without burning your knuckles when it's preheated? And so what they do is they'll drop it, they'll dump it in, and immediately when you do that, the bread starts to degas. And you want to keep those bubbles in there because that's what's going to lend to the high rise. So you want to handle it very gently. Is there a way, these are a little spendy, about $50 a piece. Is there a way to get by without investing $50 in a baking dish? Yes, but it's a little more cumbersome. You can use a pizza stone and something inverted like a Dutch oven. That's bigger, it's a lot more mass, and you're dealing with nearly 500 degrees or close to that. And the more you can burn yourself, and it's up to you, you can try it. But if you use a Dutch oven and you try to drop it in the Dutch oven and cover it with the lid of the Dutch oven while it's baking, you're going to have that problem with the high sides, again, burning your knuckles, or how do you just get it laid in there very gently without degassing it. So that's the issue. What you want to do with these lids is, in the course of the baking, over 20 minutes, it doesn't even brown. What you've done is trapped the gas or trapped the moisture inside, and it keeps the crust from forming and allows the bread to keep expanding. And when you uncover it and do the final browning, it's not even brown, and you'll see that. Now, in commercial applications, what they sometimes will do is inject steam into the oven. But unless you have a completely sealed oven that doesn't lend as amazing crust, you know, it doesn't lend an impressive crust nearly like this does. And what you're going to find, if you like really tough crust, then you cook it a different way without trapping the moisture in. It will have a very, very tough crust, one that's almost like masonite and not nearly as enjoyable. It can rip your mouth apart. So you want something that will trap the moisture inside. These baking dishes are called Superstone. That's the trademark. It's manufactured by Sassafras Enterprises Incorporated. They also make a round. I do have one of those, but I've gravitated to the longs because you get a higher crust to bread ratio, and the crust is just amazing on this. And so we like the longs over the round because you get more crust for each slice of bread. At any rate, I will be preheating these, and what I've found is that if I preheat the whole baking dish and the lid, top and bottom, then what I will do is I will burn the bottom because the bottom gets too hot. So what I'm going to do is preheat the oven with both of the lids in, and then I will preheat the bottom 6 minutes before I'm going to put the loaf in. And that, for me, it works out perfectly. Your oven might be different and you might have to adjust the times accordingly. Okay, so the bread has been rising for an hour, and I'm ready to turn on the oven. I've already turned the oven on to 465 degrees, and I'm going to preheat the lids. And one thing I did want to show you, over time, the inside and the outside will darken. And this is because the stone is porous, and it absorbs oil. And the bread, every time you put a loaf of bread in, it has a very thin coating of oil. And over time, it will layer this oil on the surface, and when it gets baked at a high temperature, it kind of makes a shellac. It's a really great non-stick surface, and it's completely normal. So I'm going to load the lids in right now. Like I mentioned, I cook it on the third level because that is off the it's far enough away from the burner, the bottom burner, that it doesn't burn the bottom of the bread. So I'm going to heat this up as long as the oven takes to heat, which is about 20 minutes. I'll be heating the lids. And then once it's up to temperature, I'm going to put in the bottoms and heat them for 6 minutes. And then I'm going to put the loaf in the bottom and cover it with the lid and bake it for 20 minutes. So. Okay, now the temperature of the oven is at 465 degrees. I've got my lids preheated. I'm going to put the bottoms in there and heat them for 6 minutes. So remember, these are smoking hot. If you touch this even for just a millisecond, it's like it'll brand you. So be careful. Set the timer for 6 minutes. Now, to look at these loaves, these are the first two, the ones. Now, what I've done is I've sprinkled some more of the sesame seeds and just a little bit of semolina flour along this edge. You'll notice I have a long edge and a short edge. This short edge should reach roughly to the center of the loaf, and you'll see why. It's because what's on the bottom is going to end up on the top, and if it's too long, it will over-rotate and the seam will be on the side. So I want to make sure that this is about center, and I did it on both, and if it's a little bit too long, you can always trim it off with some scissors. It's always better to be a little too long and have to trim it down than to have to work with something that's too short. And this, you want to maintain some longness on one side, some length on one side, so you can really hold on to it and not drop it. So in just about 5 minutes, we're going to very carefully use this parchment paper to lower it down in the dish and pull on the long side and roll the loaf so that it's seam side up. Okay, the timer just rang. It's been preheating the bottoms for 6 minutes. So this is the point where you have to work quickly and be very gentle as well. So I'm going to take these out and set them on this rack. I do this because they're very abrasive and I don't want to scrape the surface of my solid cooking surface here. So I'll shut the oven to maintain the high temperature in there. Take the lids off. Remember, these are smoking hot. Don't get burned. Now, this is where you take the paper, and it's the most gentle way I know to put bread in a cooker. You lower it in like this. You pull on the long side and let it just gently roll, making sure to give it time to release from the bread. Pull it out. That's where the semolina flour pays off. It's like little ball bearings. And you cover the dish. Here you go, like that. So that's ready to load. I'm gonna do the other one real quick. That's gonna be rotating this way, opposite direction. Pull it like that. Pull it out. And you see that we lost little, if any, of the gas that was trapped in the bread. So that looks like it's well positioned for an awesome rise. And we will gotta get the lid, make sure that it's sealed. No crack. Now I'm gonna load it in, bake it for 20 minutes. So now we're about 10 seconds before the bread is supposed to be done. And this is the time that I most look forward to see if all of the care that we took, all of the small steps that we took great care for, paid off. And we'll see what kind of a rise we got. Now I'm going to uncover it and put the lids back in here because I'm going to bake again and do two more loaves. And I want to keep the lids hot. So I'll move the lids off to the side here. Now let's take a look and see what we did here. Oh, that's great rise. And so is that. So we got a lot of loft. It almost filled the entire baking dish, which is a lot higher rise than you typically see for sourdough. Now you see how it's not even browned. I'm going to put it in before I lose my heat and brown it for about 3 to 4 minutes. Sometimes it goes up to 5, but then I start burning my bottom. Okay, so it's been browning for 3 minutes. I'm going to take a look and see if I'm happy with the browning. No, it's not quite done. I'm going to do it for another minute. Okay, so it's been browning for 4 minutes. I think I'm going to take it out. I like that. It probably wouldn't have taken 4 minutes if I had just left it in there without opening the oven. Check the bottom, see if we did. It's not bad, not too dark. A little darker than I like, but it's still good. And then we have this. Now, what I'm going to do is put the lids back in, and I'm going to wipe these out so I don't get any crumbs in there that are going to burn. And then I'll bake my other loaves. But let's take a look at these. Now, the ideal time to eat these is about 45 minutes after you take it out. This is something that you are going to be impressed with how many people comment that this does not taste like typical sourdough. And that's because typical sourdough might well be called vinegar bread. Mostly it's done with rapid rise yeast, and they put vinegar in it to make it sour. This doesn't taste nearly as sour as what they're accustomed to. It's an amazing crust, and you're going to wow the people that even think they know something about bread. I've made a lot of bread. I've given away a lot of loaves, and about 98% of everybody I give it to come back and say this was the best bread that they have ever had, even when they've traveled the world and been to places that are renowned for bread. So prepare to impress, and if you follow these steps, high likelihood of success the first time around. And I wish you all the best. Good luck.